But how about we begin with a prayer, yes? So let's start with a prayer that we have here, one of my favorites from Psalm 63. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. O God, you are my God, for you I long. For you my body yearns, for you my soul thirsts. Like a land parched, lifeless, and without water. So I look to you in the sanctuary to see your power and your glory. For your love is better than life. My lips offer you worship. Father, we ask your blessing upon this time together as we talk about prayer. Please fill us with the graces that we need to grow in our desire to have a deeper spiritual life, to grow in whatever gifts of the Holy Spirit we need, but above all, to grow in love for you who are worthy. We ask this as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, thank you all for being here. It's good to see you all. So inspiring to see, you know, we have a talk about growing in your prayer life and to see everybody show up. So great sign that you're here because you want to grow in your prayer life, right? As the talk says. So there's a series of talks that we're going to be doing. It's a 6-part series. Today is going to be an overview of the entire spiritual life. So it's an overview, general picture, because growing up Catholic, I did not know basically any of this stuff. And when I learned this in seminary of spiritual theology, my class, it was one of my favorite classes. I was like, this is amazing. People need to hear about this stuff. How did I go so many years as being a Catholic and not knowing this? And then we're going to dive into some ways of growing in that prayer life, praying through our emotions, because we all know that our emotions can get the best of us at times, and our emotions need to be brought to God as every other part of us needs to be brought to God. Then we're going to zone in on Ignatian meditation and Ignatian contemplation, this way that St. Ignatius talks about with praying with the scriptures and the life of Christ, and going through some of his rules of discernment of spirits, which are brilliant. Brilliant, one of my favorite things, favorite subjects. We'll spend a class diving in to this whole reality of prayer and inner healing, and what does that look like? Maybe give some resources to be able to take that home and spend some time with Jesus in that. And then we're going to dive into the deep end of the pool of today's an overview, and then on the 27th of June, dive into the deep end of the pool of Catholic mysticism. What are these higher stages of prayer look like? What's the deep end of the pool? What does a prayer of a saint look like? And what are some of the things that they experience that is available to us? Because the deep end of the pool does not say you know, nuns only, right? No, it says, child of God, come on in. The water's great. Now the format for tonight's talk, for all the talks, is going to be, I'm going to give you a presentation for about an hour, hopefully. As you know, Father Matt likes long homilies, and so goal is an hour. We'll see how that goes. A little bit of time for about 15 minutes of questions and answers, and then we're going to take 10-15 minutes for prayer, to actually spend some time praying, and then have another 15 minutes for a small group discussion to talk about that a little bit. Because to talk about prayer and not spend any time in prayer, I don't know, it just feels weird. So we're gonna dive into some prayer and practice. This is like they say, a teaching hospital, right? We're gonna practice what we preach. We're gonna practice what we talk about. Okay, so what are we talking about tonight, Father? Okay, so we're gonna talk about prayer and the meaning of life, because we're gonna get an overview of the spiritual life. We've got to connect it to the meaning of life. And we're gonna talk about what's called the three ages of the spiritual life, or the three ways of the spiritual life. And then these 9 grades of prayer that St. Teresa of Avila and St. John of the Cross and other great mystics of the church talk about. Some of the essentials to a deeper prayer life. Some practical tips. And then, like I said, spend some time in prayer and have some small group discussion. So now, just a disclaimer. This is an overview. My hope is at the end of this, you're like, oh, Father, I wish Father would have spent more time on this. Yeah, I had a whole semester on the spiritual life, dozens of hours on the spiritual life, and that was just the tip of the iceberg. Right? People get master's degrees and doctorates in this stuff. We can't cover everything. Tonight is just a big picture look at what's available, because so many of us grew up not knowing about this. And so the goal is to inspire you that our prayer time can be much more profoundly intimate than we may have realized. So two things. One, don't get discouraged. We start to talk about some of the mystical prayer, like, oh, I'm not there yet. Yeah, welcome to the human race. That's great. Yeah, look around. Yeah, you're not in the transforming union mystical marriage yet. Neither am I. If I was, you'd be like, Father, let's call the Pope, you know, but not there yet. No one said that yet. So that's one point. The other point is, don't get puffed up, right? Don't be tempted to be like, you know, this is where pride can come in. It's like, oh, look at me. I'm up here in this. You know, if you think you're in the transforming union, I guarantee you, you are not. Because I'm in the transforming union. It's like, saints don't talk that way. Sorry. Like, no, stay humble. Stay humble. So let's dive in. The meaning of life. It's not a secret, right? I'm trying to tell everybody, trying to get the good news out there. The meaning of life is to live in a profound communion with God. This is the purpose. This is why God created us. Gaudium et Spes, it says, the dignity of man, our dignity, rests above all on the fact that he is called to communion with God. And we're different than the rest of the people on the earth. We're different than the rest of creation. Humans are created with a great dignity. We're you know, all the other material creation can't get this. Us and the angels are created for communion with God. This invitation to converse with God is addressed to man as soon as he comes into being. For if man exists, it's because God has created him through love, and through love continues to hold him in existence. He cannot live fully according to the truth unless he freely acknowledges that love and entrusts himself to the Creator. I like that line. He cannot live fully according to the truth unless he freely acknowledges that love, the love of God, and entrusts himself to his Creator. You've been made for a deep, profound relationship. God, when he created us, he didn't want to be the 911 God, only for emergencies. He wanted to be the spouse of your soul. We're going to talk about that. That's a big claim, right? And it kind of can make people a little uncomfortable. Wait. Yeah, marriage exists to point to a greater reality. Marriage is a sacrament that points to a greater union. Now, one of my favorite lines in the catechism, I have lots of favorite lines in the catechism, but this is number one, or either number one or number two, depending on the day. God's very being is love. We know this. God is love, right? By sending his only Son and the Spirit of love in the fullness of time, God has revealed his innermost secret. You're like, whoa, innermost secret? That's pretty important, yeah. We'll talk about this on Holy Trinity Sunday. Greatest secret ever kept in the history of the human race. That God himself is an eternal exchange of love. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And he has destined us to share in that exchange. Now this is worth its own hours and hours of prayer and meditation. That God, we know that God exists as a Trinity. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, they exist as an eternal exchange of love. Father pouring out infinite love, and the infinite self is infinite divine nature to the Son. The Son receiving that infinite divine nature and love and pouring himself out to the Father. And the love between them is so infinite, so personal, so real. It is a person, a divine person of the Holy Spirit. And we're actually called not to just look at the Trinity from a distance and be like, wow, that's really cool. No, he actually wants us to share in the exchange of love between the Father and the Son. He wants us to participate in the exchange of infinite love between the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we fully understood what that was. We'd be like, just go into ecstasy. We wouldn't be able to handle it. We'd be like, it was amazing. Right? Now, I'll put it out there. Hopefully you guys are all very familiar with this line. From St. Augustine, you have made us for yourselves. Our hearts are restless until they rest in you, right? We're made for God. And I just want to emphasize this point Because sometimes we get caught up, right? We get caught up in, no, I'm made for that new car, I'm made for that new iPhone, I'm made for that latest entertainment, this thing and that thing. It's like, you've been made for the infinite love of God, and nothing less is worthy of your soul. Nothing less is enough. Nothing less will satisfy. Everything else is supposed to help pursue, right? This is the line of St. Ignatius of Loyola. Man is created to praise, reverence, and serve God our Lord, and by this means to save his soul. He's supposed to use all the things on the earth in as much as it helps him to pursue that end and to rid himself of them, in as much as they hinder the pursuit of that end. Right? We've been made for union with God. Or the Catechism's way of saying it, Catechism paragraph 1. Beginning, first thing, they just jump. I think it's so cool. Paragraph 1, meaning of life. Here it is. God, infinitely perfect and blessed in himself, in a plan of sheer goodness, freely created man to make him share in his own blessed life. That's why you exist, to share in the blessed life of God. For this reason, at every time and in every place, God draws close to man. God is trying to draw close to you. From heaven, we'll be able to see our lives and see all the ways that God was just like knocking on the door, trying to get close to us, trying to draw near to us. He calls man to seek him, to know him, to love him with all his strength. He calls together all men scattered and divided by sin into the unity of his family, the church. To accomplish this, when the fullness of time had come, God sent his Son as Redeemer and Savior. In his Son and through him, he invites men to become in the Holy Spirit his adopted children, and thus heirs of his blessed life. Right? Thus heirs of his blessed life through the sonship of Jesus. Okay, so this is at the heart of the good news. We want to keep prayer in the context of the good news. God exists as an eternal exchange of love between the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. God created us to share in his own blessed life and wants an intimate relationship with us. Of course, we know the tragedy, right? Adam and Eve rejected sharing in the life of God. We're going to go our own way, tree of knowledge, good and evil, over the tree of life. And so what does God do? The Son of God, the second person of the Trinity, shares our life, takes on our nature. Says, you've rejected union with me, communion with me. I will take on a human body and a human soul. I will forever have union with God and man in myself, in Jesus Christ, right? He has forever wedded himself to humanity, forever united his divinity and humanity in the person of Jesus Christ, and offers his life for our salvation. And we can be restored to supernatural life. We can participate in the life of God again, the supernatural life of God, live our purpose of participating in the life of the Holy Trinity through Jesus Christ, through the sacraments that he gives us, through the life of prayer. So beautiful. How many people do not know what they're made for? Do not know how sacred, how awesome is their dignity, what they've been created for, and are just foraging in the dirt, right? Now, when we talk about the spiritual life, this, what does it look like to participate in the life of God? I want to just connect these two points that are going to make sense, obviously, is that we talk about we're called to participate in the life of God, and we do that by participating in the life of Jesus Christ. He is the one mediator between God and man. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the one. There is no other salvation except in him. And we know that through the waters of baptism. That's why I like this image, right? That Christ's life, Christ's death and resurrection has come into that child. The Holy Spirit's being poured out. And so we know this in Scripture through the sacraments, that when we are baptized, you not know all of us have been baptized into Christ, or Christ Jesus were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death. So as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. And so our redemption comes from, our salvation comes from participating in the redemption of Jesus Christ by being united to Jesus Christ, where he is living in us and we in him. He says this in it says this in many places, but in these two beautiful lines where Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He's the life of the soul. He's the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And then just in a few verses later, he says, I live. You will live also. In that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. This sharing in the life of God through Christ. Now, one of my favorite saints, St. John Eudes, he said it this way. He said, just as Jesus is in his Father, living his life, which the Father communicates to him. Everything that Jesus has is from the Father. It's communicated from the Father. So also you are in Jesus, living by his life, and he is in you, giving you this same life. Thus he lives in you, and you live in and with him. Right? So he's communicating his divine life to us. We're sharing in his life. He's living in us through sanctifying grace. Now, we're going to take it to the next step here. So the Catechism actually references St. John Eudes, this work, the life and kingdom of Jesus Christ in Christian souls. So first it says, Christ enables us to live in him all that he himself lived, and he lives it in us, right? So the spiritual life is a participation in the life of Christ. It is Jesus living his life in us, his offering of himself to the Father, his love for the Father, his living out his mysteries as well. So it says, you know, all of our Christian life, all of our spiritual life is supposed to be revolving around Christ, revolving around the Holy Trinity. We do not seek some type of, oh, have you tried this like new agey, get some crystals and like chant this thing and or go up this mountain and stand on this thing. No, our whole Catholic mysticism is about union with God through Jesus Christ, who is true God and true man, who is the union of God and man in himself. It's personal. It's always personal. If you have a Catholic, if you have someone trying to offer you a spirituality that is depersonalized, that's talking about you just need to focus on a candle and then blow out the candle. No, I'm sorry, you need to focus on the persons of the Trinity. You need to focus on Jesus Christ. So he says, we must continue to accomplish in ourselves the stages of Jesus' life and his mysteries, and often to beg him to perfect and realize them in us and in his whole church. For it is the plan of the Son of God to make us and the whole church partake in his mysteries and to extend them and to continue them in us and his whole church. This is the plan for fulfilling his mysteries in us. So these stages of Christ's life, we're called to participate in the life of Christ. That's why it's so beautiful that the church, what do? Every year, we go through the life of Christ. Every year, we go through the life of Christ. Because it's his life that sanctifies. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Okay, so now that's the foundation stones, is participating in the life of Christ, made to share in the life of Christ, and the stages of Christ's life matter to us. We're called to live out the stages of Christ's life. So the spiritual life is going to look like Christ's life. We're going to be able to see the stages of his life is going to provide wisdom for our sanctification. Now, he's perfect. He's got the beatific vision. Jesus is walking around with the beatific vision his entire life. He is not going through stages of sanctification or purification. He's got nothing to be purified from. He is holy. He is living the beatific vision. He is living the heavenly reality here on earth because he's God. He can't stop being God, right? He can't deny himself. But for us, as we grow in holiness, our life, his life are going to intermingle. So now this is the overview that you have on the back sheet there, on the one side of the sheet there. And then we're going to dive into this a little bit. And so we talk about in the spiritual life, we talk about these two parts of the spiritual life called the ascetical life and the mystical life. We talk about the three stages of the spiritual life, purgative, illuminative, and unitive. And we talk about the nine grades of prayer. So we got 2, 3, 2, 3, 9. So now the ascetical life, and I'll jump back to the slide in a minute. The ascetical life is the life of prayer, the spiritual life that any person is capable of with ordinary human effort and grace. It's kind of like the analogy of learning how to swim. If you got arms and legs, you can learn how to swim. Right, or learn how to ride a bike. And so these stages of the spiritual life, like vocal prayer, of course, use your voice, talk to God. Meditation or mental prayer, which we'll talk about especially the next couple weeks. Affective prayer, acquired recollection, prayer of simplicity, which we're going to dive into a little bit today. You know, these are stages of prayer that are available to any person who with ordinary effort and they're pursuing holiness and ordinary graces. The mystical life, these are mystical stages of prayer that are supernatural. This is the walking on water level stuff. that you can't accomplish by, like, I'm going to try really hard to do the prayer of transforming union. That's not how that works. You try, I'm going to try really hard to walk on water. Get a life jacket, dude, because you're going down, you're going in. Like, no, these are mystical grades of prayer that are available. God wants to take people there. They're not for a selected few. God wants to take people there if they're ready, if they're pursuing holiness. These, any single one of us can be get to the heights of union, but these are mystical, completely supernatural. They're initiated and directly sustained by God. And so infused contemplation, prayer of quiet, union, conforming union, transforming union are called the mystical marriage. Okay, so you have these two big phases or stages called the ascetical life and the mystical life. And then these three ways, three ages, sometimes called the three conversions of the spiritual life. And I put in there kind of how they, where Christ's life kind of parallels or gives wisdom for. And so first the step is our conversion. Just as Christ took on a human body and a human soul, we have to actually be made new. So if we're spiritually dead, we don't have any spiritual life, we're spiritually dead. And so going to confession or getting baptized, we're not baptized, where we receive sanctifying grace in our soul. And then we live this initial life, with the ascetical life of trying to get out of sin, trying to turn away from, not only stay out of mortal sin, which would take us back before our conversion, or we're turned away from God, by staying out of venial sin, trying to grow in virtue, trying to grow in our prayer life, trying to grow in faith, hope, and charity, grow in holiness. And through so this these stages of purification, this called the purgative way. And then we enter into a purgation that God initiates, called the dark night of the senses. Just like Jesus, the Holy Spirit drove him out into the desert for 40 days, and he ate nothing, fasted for 40 days. The dark night of the senses is our way of sharing in that type of purification, where the Lord is living that moment of his life in us, purifies us to bring us to the illuminative way. And we're going to go into this a little bit more. In the illuminative way, we're experiencing these mystical graces, mystical contemplation, infused knowledge, and, you know, heroic charity. So these are mystical stages of prayer, inebriations of divine love. And then the Lord invites us to share in something even deeper, to share in a deeper participation in his cross, a deeper participation in the offering of himself to the Father by the dark night of the soul, which parallels or participates in the Christ's agony of the garden. Christ is living out that offering in the darkness. We're entering into Christ, all that Christ went through there. Because again, the spiritual life is about union with Christ. And the more we love Christ, the more we're not seeking peace. We're not seeking happiness. We're not seeking a feeling. We are seeking a person. We're seeking union with a person that we love. This is sometimes called the divine romance. We are seeking the Lord himself. And if you love someone, you want to share in their life, right? When your kids are sick, you want to be like, all right, call me when you're done with that. Send me a text when you're done with that. No, you're like, I want to be there, right? Yeah, it's difficult. Yeah, it's challenging. But when love seeks to share everything, even the tough stuff, especially the tough stuff. Because if someone you love is going through something tough, you want to be there. You want to console them. And so the dark night of the soul, as difficult as it is a purification of the soul. It's sharing in Christ. We're saying, no, I don't want you to be alone in the agony of the garden. I want to be there. And then he enters into this unitive way. The soul is captivated by God, lives in this constant union, is experiencing spiritual ecstasies, which we'll talk about in a minute, and these mystical touches from God. There's heroic suffering. This is, if you're in the unitive way, I mean, you're a saint level living. In my life, I think I have met one, maybe two, maybe three people in my life that I thought could have been the unitive way. I know at least, well, one of them is still alive. Two of them have passed away. I know one of them, if she was in Italy, she'd probably be canonized by now. But, you know, that's what happens. Us Americans, we struggle to get the paperwork done, I guess. I don't know how the Italians always get people canonized so quickly, but we can't seem to get it done quicker. But anyway, and then you go to heaven, right? So the unitive way is the closest you can be to God, the most sanctified you can be with God outside of heaven. Okay, so now I mentioned these conversions, sometimes they're called the three conversions of the spiritual life, because they are, you are being converted, you are being purified and being sanctified. The first conversion happening at baptism or confession, entering into the purgative way, conversion into the illuminative way through the darkening of the senses, which is impossible without sanctifying grace, right? You can't get there, you can't have mystical contemplation if you're spiritually dead. And then the conversion of the darkening of the unitive way through the darkening of the soul. Okay, so let's go into this a little bit more. How are we doing on time? Doing good. All right. So in the purgative way, the person is turned away from a life of mortal sin to follow Jesus Christ. Hopefully we're all at least in the purgative way, right? Although they may still struggle with temptation, still struggle with venial sins, may, you know, of course, if they're falling back into mortal sin, to get to confession right away. But this is, they're at the their beginning of the spiritual life where the Lord is wanting to purify, wanting to make his home in their hearts through sanctifying grace, and to fill every aspect of that person's life with his presence, his love, his grace. So they're trying to purify themselves. And in this, we can experience spiritual consolations in prayer. Presumably many of you have. Sometimes we'll go into that, what the details of that are, but, you know, for example, like feeling loved by God or experiencing some type of peace when you were praying, whether it's even praying a rosary or praying in the Adoration Chapel or something, where you felt like the Lord just, or Scripture just spoke to you. So these are we can experience consolations and desolations. So now this is St. Ignatius of Loyola, one of my favorite authors in the spiritual life. He says, what is spiritual consolation? So it's some interior movement of the soul is caused through which the soul comes to be inflamed with love of its Creator and Lord. So an interior movement of the soul inflamed with love of its Creator, and when it can in consequence love no created thing on the face of the earth in itself, but in the Creator of them all. Likewise, when it sheds tears that move to love of its Lord, whether to sorrow for one's sins or for the passion of Christ our Lord, or because of other things directly connected with his service and praise. Finally, I call consolation every increase of hope, faith, and charity, all interior joy, which calls and attracts to heavenly things and to the salvation of one's soul, quieting it and giving it peace in its Creator and Lord. So, some type of interior movement of the soul towards God, towards being inflamed with love, increase of faith, hope, and charity, some type of interior joy or peace. We can think of those as spiritual consolations. You know, we, of course, understand like kind of natural consolation. Father Matt's homily is done. Yay! You know, that's a kind of natural happiness. Or, you know, if some sports team wins whatever game we want them to win, yay, that's kind of a natural joy, you know. There are spiritual joys, spiritual consolations. And, you know, it's sad. There's a lot of Catholics who grew up thinking, like, that's not possible. Right, like, oh no, I say my prayers. It's boring, but it's what I do. It's like, it's not meant to be boring. God's not boring. He doesn't think you're boring. So why would a relationship with him be boring? If it's boring, something's got to change, right? Just like in a marriage, if you're bored with your spouse, it's not because they're boring and it's not because you're boring. It's because the way you're interacting is boring. Because that person is a child of God. That person is a deep mystery to them. They have a profound dignity. There's a whole lot going on in the soul of every person. Okay, so we got spiritual consolations, we got spiritual desolations that we can experience as well, and presumably everybody in this room has experienced them to some degree. So St. Ignatius, again, he gives us the definition. I call desolation all the contrary of the third rule, which is consolation. So darkness of soul, disturbance in it, movements to things lowly and earthly. Consolation, movement to the things of God, movement to God. Desolation, movement to things lowly and earthly. The unquiet of different agitations and temptations. Moving to want of confidence, without hope, without love. And one finds oneself all lazy, tepid, and sad, as if separated from his Creator and Lord. Because as consolation is contrary to desolation, in the same way the thoughts that come from consolation are contrary to the thoughts that come from desolation. So consolation, we're moving towards God. Desolation, we're moving away. Now, we talk about these two things. It's important to make a distinction. Sometimes people get confused and they kind of think that they're all the same thing. So dryness in prayer is not the same thing as desolation. Dryness might just mean you just don't feel moved one way or the other. Where in desolation, you're moving, you feel like, I don't feel like praying versus just like, prayer isn't doing anything for me versus I don't feel like it. So, and then that's not the same. Dryness and desolation are not the same thing as the dark night of the senses. Sometimes people experience dryness and like, oh, I'm in the dark night of the senses. No, you've just been watching too much television. Like, your mind is confused. You're trying to go pray and you're just like, mch, mch, mch. Like, that's just, so we can cause our own dryness by our worldliness. We can cause our own desolation by worldliness. And dryness and desolation can be both spiritual. They can happen on a spiritual level and on a non-spiritual level. Right? We can have desolation and dryness in prayer on a non-spiritual level because we lost a loved one, and we're grieving, and so we don't feel like doing anything. And so that's creating a non-spiritual desolation because we don't feel like doing anything, which includes prayer. Well, that's not a spiritual desolation, it just means it's grief, and you got to deal with your grief, right? The good thing is God does not cause desolation. And we all experience, if you're in the spiritual life long enough, everybody's going to experience it, but it's not caused by God. He allows it, and so he can withdraw his consolation and we'll experience dryness, but he doesn't cause the movement away from himself. He can't do that. He can't cause the movement away from himself. He can withdraw consolation, but then something comes in. Either we're our own worst enemies, and we kind of trip ourselves up and cause our own desolation, or the evil one comes in to tempt us in a moment of dryness when consolation is withdrawn to kind of wreck the train, to kind of move away towards God. I'll give you an example. Let's say God is inviting us to a deeper prayer, and so he's inviting us, we're having a little bit of dryness, so that he wants us to choose him. And then, but we think that dryness is, God doesn't love me, God hates me. Well, you're going to wreck the train, man. If you actually think God hates you, are you going to want to go pray to God? You want to spend time with the one who hates you? No, one who you think hates you. So you're going to, that's, our own thoughts are going to then spiral out of control into desolation of not feeling like doing anything because we've had a lie, we bought the lie either of our own wounds or of the evil one of, oh, God must hate me if I'm not experiencing consolation and peace at every time I go to pray. No, God can withdraw. God always has a good purpose, and if he withdraws consolation, it's not because he's mad at us, because we've turned away from him, or because he wants it to bring up greater purification. And so that's where all the spiritual authors, especially St. Ignatius, talks about we got to notice what's going on in our spiritual life. Oops. Discern, okay, we got to notice what's happening, discern it, figure it out, bring the principles of the discernment of spirits to it, like bring the wisdom of the church to it, and then take action. Now, great book, one of his best, in my opinion, on all of the consolation, desolation, dryness, dark night of the senses, like non-spiritual desolation and dryness, non-spiritual desolation and dryness, and their remedies. Is a book by Father Timothy Gallagher, Struggles in the Spiritual Life. It was just released last year. It is super good. Highly recommend. That is like bookshelf, is good stuff. He's a great author, by the way. I've read a lot of his stuff, but that's one of my favorites. Okay, so we talked about consolation, desolation. Now let's go into some of the stages of prayer. Again, this is an overview. So you're like, Father Matt's fire hosing us. That was the point of tonight. If you didn't know the fire hose was coming tonight, tonight's the fire hose. That's what you're getting tonight. That's your lot. So we know vocal prayer. I'm not going to spend a ton of time on that because everybody here is familiar with vocal prayer. And I would say, I imagine that vast majority are. We'll have questions at the end, okay? So vocal prayer is speaking to God from the heart. It can be formal prayers like Our Fathers and Hail Marys, liturgical prayer like the Mass. Or spontaneous prayers. I love you, Lord. You're so good and merciful, right? And so the key in vocal prayer, amongst there's many things. We could have a whole class on how to have better vocal prayer. But the keys are devotion and recollection. Mean what you say and pay attention to the one that you're talking to, right? And so devotion and recollection. And then the second stage of prayer, meditation and mental prayer. We're going to have 2 weeks on that, two classes on that, where we're reflecting, using our mind, using our reason to reflect on who God is, his attributes, his goodness, his mercy, the life of Christ, so that we can then interact with him more profoundly, love him more, get to know him better, Right, so if we're meditating on the crucifixion and we think of Jesus' words, or thinking about Jesus' words, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. That's going to inspire us. Lord, you're so kind and merciful. We are literally murdering you and you're praying for our forgiveness. That is so amazing. You're so good. Right? And so it can inspire great movements of the heart, can inspire conviction, meditation. And we're going to emphasize that. Mental prayer and meditation is so critical for growth in the spiritual life. So many people don't grow because they don't learn how to do mental prayer or meditate. And so they kind of, these are the prayers I do, Father. This is what I do. It's great. It's great that you're praying. That's awesome. I'm not trying to make people feel bad. But if we want to grow in intimacy, then we can take the next step. So sometimes that's talked about as Lectio Divina, Ignatian meditation. I mentioned this next stage of prayer. Now, I guess I should say now, when I talk about stages of prayer, so it's not like levels in a video game. Right? Levels of video game, you're like, okay, I got to level 2 of Mario, and now I go back to level 1 and redo level 1. Now, we talk about stages in prayer because what's happening is what prayer is most dominant. Now, someone in the heights of transforming union is still going to go to Mass. They're still going to pray in Our Father. They're still going to have vocal prayer. So it's not like you never experience anything from the previous stages when you get to the higher stages of prayer. It's just, what is your dominant way of praying? What's the dominant way of going through the spiritual life? Especially so you never leave vocal prayer. It's part of our lives as people with bodies and voices. Now, there's going to come a time where meditation is going to be fruitless because the Lord is trying to bring the person to contemplation, but they're still going to pray at Mass. So I just wanted to say that it's not like levels in a video game. There's just what's the dominant way of praying in that spiritual life? What is the Lord primarily doing? So an affective prayer is a prayer of the heart, where love dominates, where the will and the heart dominate more than the intellect. So in meditation, we're trying to use our reason and imagination to kind of put us in the scene, to try to draw convictions, get to know Jesus better so we can better love him and serve him. And then even in meditation, we might have moments of affective prayer, like, the person praying with the crucifix, praying with the crucifixion scene. Lord, you're so, and we're just moved by the mercy of God, and we just focus on love. I love you, Lord. And just this prayer of the heart becomes spontaneously wells up within us. I love you, Lord. You're so kind. You're so merciful. And yeah, I'm using words to express what's in the heart right now because you're listening to me, but there's a movement of the heart, the affective part of us. Now, the spiritual authors will say that it's impossible to practice affective prayer without some form of meditation because you can't love what you're not thinking about, right? They say, do you love John Doe over in Clayton, Michigan? You're like, I don't know John Doe. I don't know how much. Yeah, you got to be thinking about a person to be able to love them. Got to be able to have them in. Got to be having them in your intellect to be able to be moved by the will. And so, we start with meditation, and then try to, when the heart starts to move to love, we stop with our kind of reasoned thought of this and that and the other thing, and we just focus on loving. So this is like the moments where you can kind of see this parallel in human relationships, right? You're on a date with your fiance, or you've been dating for a year, and you love this person, and you look at them, and they look at you, and they smile at you, and you're just like, I love you, right? There's an affective movement of the heart that's going with, because you're moved, because you see them, and the goodness of them is moving your heart. So kind of like, so that's the human level, but with God. Now, and this, of course, one of the benefits, it moves us out of ourselves to actively loving God, and that's going to bring refreshment to the soul. The only danger is we want to make sure that we don't over-emotionalize or get kind of addicted to, I just love emoting. Wait, I thought you loved God. No, I just love, like, okay, see the difference? I just love pouring out emotions. Wait a second, whoa. Where we start to focus on the feeling rather than the love, on the person. Very, very, so that's the danger of any type of affective prayer. And you see this in relationships, right? Like, I just love being in love. Don't even, or they just make me, why? Like I'll say this to couples and when they're preparing for marriage, they'll say, why do you love this person? Oh, they make me happy, they make me laugh, they make me feel good about myself. I'm like, what does that sound? Sounds selfish, of course, right? It's very self-focused. Now, I don't say that to them. It never sounds selfish, right? That'd be rude. I, you know, be like, not getting married by you. No, so, no, but hopefully the relationship has to mature where it's not how that person makes me feel, but who that person is, right? So that's the danger where, yeah, we want to respond with the heart. We can love, and I'm not talking about this huge, like super emotional thing because people can be like, Father, I don't have strong emotions. Like I have my personality, my temperament, melancholic, like I'm a train. Like it takes me a while to get moving. If you come to me like, Father Matt, get excited. You just won the lottery. And I'm like, yay. Like, that's good. Like, I'm not going to have this strong emotional reaction like someone with a different temperament, but like, woohoo, you know, that's not how I roll. I can get the train moving, and you've seen that at Mass, where I'm getting more and more passionate as I talk about things I love. And so we don't want to confuse like, oh, this person, I just have such emotions, and I can just cry at an instant. You know, it's something deeper than just an emotional experience, right? You can experience love for a person even if you're not bawling your eyes out in that moment. You can experience a deeper part of you. And then we want to, of course, avoid pride. If we experience this affective moment of prayer, it doesn't mean, oh, I'm so holy. I have such great love for God. I'm a saint. Whoa, whoa, whoa. That's not how saints talk. No, this is just a beginning stage of prayer. But the fruits of this prayer can be a more intense practice of Christian virtue, a purity of intention, I want to do this for love of God, a spirit of self-denial, an increase in charity, for fidelity one's duties, but want to make sure that God stays the focus. Okay, so now let's, again, we're going through an overview. If you want these notes, I can always send them to you. I didn't know how many people are going to be here, so I didn't print out like 8 pages of notes per person. So after affective prayer comes this prayer of simplicity. This is the end of the ascetical life, the beginning, moving towards the mystical life. The prayer of simplicity, or sometimes called acquired recollection, is a loving gaze. A loving gaze upon God or some divine object, whether on God himself or one of his perfections, on Christ or one of his mysteries or on some other Christian truth. Now, on a natural level, not on a prayer level, we might have experienced kind of an analogy to this. When you see a beautiful sunset and you're just like, whoa, right? Or if you're holding your baby for the first time, you're like, oh, right? Where you're just loving and gazing and you're just kind of captivated by the baby. And you're not really thinking a bunch of thoughts. You're just loving and gazing upon that child. It's got you, you know? Better than TV, right? Just, not even doing anything, right? It's amazing, right? What love, what the goodness of a child and the love, your love for them can produce. And so that's kind of a natural analogy where someone has been thinking about the Lord, meditating, they move towards loving the Lord, and then there's just a focused loving. Now, if you spend time in the Adoration Chapel, my guess is, and you're zoning in at staring at Jesus, and you're trying to pray, you might have moments of this ascetical type of prayer of simplicity, where you're just staring at the Eucharist and your heart's moved and you're captivated, you're not having a bunch of thoughts, you're just zoned in. Maybe it's 10 seconds, maybe it's 30 seconds, maybe it's half an hour, maybe it's a whole hour. I don't know, but I think if you spend time in the Adoration Chapel enough and you put down, you know, books are fine, but you got to make sure you're not just spending the whole hour reading. What'd you do? Well, I read, I don't know, can't think of a secular book at the moment of One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest or something. It's like, well, I don't know what that's supposed to help you with. Why don't you read the Bible, right? Like, okay, so we, you know, read the scriptures and then look up at the Lord. That was you, Lord, you did that. That was you right there, you know, and you kind of get captivated for a moment. So in the purgative way, we're also experiencing these. We're choosing to purify our lives. This is called active purification. So we're trying to turn away from the noise of the world, the purification of the external senses, you know. I'm not going to just be, I got the headphones on, I got my phone on, and I got all this stuff. I watch 8 hours of Netflix. You're going to have a hard time growing in your prayer life, man. If your prayer to TV ratio is that bad, like some people's prayer to TV ratio, they wonder why they can't grow in prayer. And let's be honest, your prayer to TV ratio is probably 100 to 1. It's going to be hard to grow in prayer if that ratio is 100 to 1. You know, oh, I spend about 2 minutes a day. You know, like so we try to turn away from that noise. And then the purification of the memory and the imagination, so we're not looking back at past sins, but we're focusing on the Lord. We're not imagining sinful fantasies. We're imagining the Lord and His life, seeking to purify our passions, our emotional life, the movements within us. So we're not pursuing desires for sin, but we're trying to foster desires for holiness. Purifying our intellect by growing in the knowledge of the truth and divine revelation so we can conform our mind to the Lord, and then purifying the will so we can conform our lives to the Lord. So these are the purifications that we're choosing to pursue to grow in holiness. But then the Lord's always stepping up. He's always helping us throughout all of this. But then the Lord wants to take us he wants to purify us at a level that we can't get to. So think of the active purifications, they're like the scalpel, right? We're trying to cut out the cancer. The passive purifications, they're the radiation therapy, where he's just going to radiate, he's just going to bring a soul to a purification. He's going to do open heart surgery and say, all right, let me take you to some place you can't get to. And so the dark night of the senses is this time, this purification initiated by God to prepare it for mystical contemplation, to detach it from trying to find God in external sensible consolations. I feel God close to me when I feel loved by God. I feel His peace. Okay, those are real graces. I'm not trying to diminish those. But feeling peace is not God. That's feeling peace that God made you feel. But peace is not God. God is God. Right? If your spouse tells you a joke and makes you laugh, the laughter is not your spouse. The spouse is your spouse. Right? If they make you cry, the crying is not your spouse. If they make you feel loved, the feeling loved is not your spouse. And so sometimes in the spiritual life, we get confused. We think the feeling is God, and we get attached to the feeling like we're attached to God. And the Lord's like, no, I'm producing this in you. This is an effect of grace, but I'm more than this. There's more to me than just being able to make you feel something. And that's how relationships have to grow, right? From the person who says, why do you love this person? Because they make me happy. Well, that's focusing on a feeling versus I actually like them. And who they are is amazing. You know, who they are in themselves, regardless of how they make me feel. And so the Lord pulls back on these feelings, these consolations, these sensible consolations, the sweetness of prayer, so that we can focus on Him Himself. So where we were used to, we kind of think of this image of a field, right? Where we're used to sitting and having a picnic in these kind of sensible consolations. All right, Lord, let's have a picnic and let's feel, I want to experience peace and experience love. And I'm not trying to downplay it. You know, these are real graces from the Lord, and we should, if the Lord wants to give them, we should receive them. You know, we don't have to push them away. It's not like, oh, that's beneath me. Lord, if the Lord's pouring out His love, that's not beneath you. Receive what He wants to receive, what He wants to give. If He wants to give a consolation, then receive it. But when he steps up from that picnic and says, actually, I'm going to go over here. And you're like, whoa, where'd you go? Where'd you go? Right? This is the dark night of the senses, where we're like, come on, Lord, show up at the picnic. I like this picnic. And we're like, actually, I have a huge banquet over here for you. And they're like, no, I like the picnic. People don't like change. Right? And so we're going to experience the desert of that, because He's not pouring out graces here. One of the encouraging things is when it says in the dark night of the senses, the spiritual authors will talk about this, like Father Gerlou Lagrange and St. John of the Cross, to say when the dark night of the senses is happening, it's because God is wanting to give the grace of contemplation. The faucet is on, the picnic, the banquet is prepared, but we're just like, come on, show up at this picnic. I like that feeling. And so we experience that as darkness. We're not aware of the grace that's available to us because we're so focused. And so in the desert then, when there's a desert, we're like, okay, Lord, where are you? I want to focus in on you. And so the key is, if we're experiencing this darkness of the senses, because you can't produce it. It's a mystical prayer. If he wants to give you contemplation, he's got to lift you up. He's got to take you there. You just can't be focused. You can't be like, I want to feel this. I'm mad at you. Right now we're going to cause desolation. If we start getting mad at God, I like this feeling, I mean back my feeling, right? We'll throw a little temper tantrum. If you guys are any, none of us have ever thrown a temper tantrum in prayer, never, none of us. You know, of course we all have. If you've been had a prayer life long enough, you're like, come on, God, why aren't you doing something? You know, and it's like, okay, hold on, hold on. Because we can cause our own desolation out of that. But in darkened senses, meditation is difficult, it's fruitless. But God is calling us to a deeper prayer. And so to stay focused on Him, to stay focused on believing in Him and persevering. It's like, no, I seek you. I seek you. I can place myself in your presence. I'm going to praise you. This is like where the Gloria at Mass. What do we do at the Gloria? We just focus on praising God. Right? We're not, I just want you to pick me up. I just want to be with you. I want your will. I just want to stay focused on you, Lord. Because even if I don't feel your presence, I know you are still here. That's a very key point. Just because you don't feel His presence, it doesn't mean God has abandoned you. It's impossible for God to abandon you. You would cease to exist. If God wasn't intimately close to you, you would cease to exist. You can't, just because you can't feel Him close to you doesn't mean He isn't close to you. Doesn't mean He's abandoned you. And so that's where faith comes in. Say, no, God, I know you can't abandon me. You never abandon me. You said I'm with you always. I believe it. Just because I don't feel your presence, my feelings are not you. My feelings are not God. And my feelings are not the ultimate gauge of truth. Your word is truth. I know you said I'm with you always. You said that you loved me. And I believe it. And I'm going to sit here and wait. And I'm going to keep focused on you. Because I know where you live, for one, in the Eucharist. Right? Can't hide from me in the Eucharist. I know you're in my soul, even if I don't feel your presence. If we're in a state of grace, He's living in our soul. I know you're still here. I know you're still here. And to be able to pour out love, to be still focused on Him. And that's the attitude, this recollection, this devotion, this faith, this persevering trust and love, choosing Him. And then eventually the Lord's going to be like, whoop, and grab your heart and your mind and bring you to the illuminative way of mystical contemplation. And so, and if someone is in the dark night of the senses, that's where meeting with the priest, if they're really struggling and they're like, I don't know what's going on, it can be pretty vital. To not train wreck, because a lot of people will start to experience moments of the dark night of the senses and then train wreck because they think God's abandoned me, prayer is useless, there's no point, what's on TV, you know, and they'll just go back to worldliness. They're like, well, okay, and it becomes this kind of compromise of, well, I'll have this much prayer and I'll have this much world because I gotta take control of things, right? God kind of let me down. He was making me happy, and then He stopped, and so I got to kind of like, okay, God, you get this much, but I got to make sure I'm happy. So, come on, world, let's make this happen, right? God and world, and we try to live in both worlds. We try to be people of the kingdom of God and people of the kingdom of the world to try to make ourselves happy instead of just go all in. He's trustworthy. Just be stay focused on Him. Oh man, okay, 5 minutes. A lot more. We're on 33 of 54 here. Oh goodness. Okay. So in the illuminative way, again, this is an overview, so I can just keep talking and talking because my favorite subject is the spiritual life. So the way of infused contemplation, wherein God Himself teaches and refreshes the soul without meditation or any active efforts. This is the walking on water stuff, and the person is going to be living a life of virtue. They're going to be experiencing mystical contemplation where God is present to the soul in a completely supernatural way, initiated and sustained by Him. As I mentioned before, not possible without sanctifying grace. So we'll talk more about this when we talk about mystical prayer, but I just want to mention what contemplation is not. Contemplation is not an emptying of the mind to focus on nothingness. That's Eastern, that's Buddhist, that's Oriental stuff, that's not Christian. That's where I use that image of like, oh, just focus on the candle and then blow out the candle and just be in nothing, right? People will do that because they're seeking peace and they think there's peace through nothingness, peace through just let the mind go of everything. No, our mind, you let the world go so that we can make room for Christ. Our prayers always focus on God, always focused on His essence. We're never isolated, we're never alone, we're never focused on nothingness, we're always focused on Him. Contemplation is not a prayer that we can produce on our own efforts. And sometimes you'll hear contemplative prayer used, even by St. Ignatius. Sometimes that word contemplation, because he'll use Ignatius contemplation, and he doesn't mean mystical contemplation. Well, but people will use contemplation differently in our world. Oh, this is my contemplative prayer group. And what is the prayer? They're trying to foster a quieting of the mind. And that's not a bad thing, but it's not. And so they talk about contemplative prayer, but it's not what they don't mean like mystical, supernatural prayer initiated by God. They mean like more just like being recollected, quieting down. Well, that's recollection. That's a important component of prayer, but it's not contemplative prayer. And contemplation is not mindfulness. You see that word used properly. Mindfulness is just where, now people use that word very differently, but basically like just be aware of your present moment. Well, that's just being aware of your present moment. That's not prayer, right? This is a mystical state of prayer. Now, I'll just give you a couple of examples of this, a mystical. So you had infused contemplation, and then we got the prayer of quiet. We'll talk more about this a little bit. I just wanna touch on it a bit. A type of mystical prayer in which the intimate awareness of God, of God's presence, captivates the will and fills the soul and body with ineffable sweetness and delight. How's that sound for you? Sounds pretty good, right? And now, St. Teresa of Avila says, the content and delight are not felt as earthly delights are felt in the heart. It arises in a much more interior part, like something of which springs from the very deep. Some which springs are very deep. I think this must be the center of the soul. This is a mystical prayer. It's not like this. I feel this peace. I feel this love, right? That's kind of spiritual consolation. This is mystical contemplation. This is a much deeper reality. One of the things that can happen is called concomitant mystical phenomenon. Say that five times fast. Concomitant mystical phenomenon. So in the midst of these mystical prayers, there's stuff that happens at the same time. That's not the prayer, but it's happening with the prayer. And so sometimes with the prayer of quiet is the sleep of the faculties. So the prayer of quiet captivates the will, but the intellect remains free. In the sleep of the faculties, the intellect and the will are captivated. You can't really think about other stuff, your attention, your intellect, your attention, and your will are focused, are captivated, but you still have your imagination and memory free. Those are going to be captivated in deeper stages of prayer. And you experience these inebriations of love. We're just overwhelmed. It's like, I mean, it's not a drunkenness, obviously, but it's just an overwhelming foolishness of love, so intense it cannot be contained. And in the midst of all of this, God is purifying the soul through these mystical contemplations. In the illuminative way, God can purify the soul in just an instant. Something you're struggling with, you go into prayer, the Lord shows up. This is like radiation therapy. It's like, just God, just boom, it's gone. You're like, what happened? I was like, you were with Jesus, and His radiance changed you. Infused knowledge can happen where God can convey in a moment what would take days to, or take minutes or hours to explain. It's infused. God just infuses knowledge and understanding. All these miraculous things that can happen. And the Lord then wants to take a person through the agony of the garden into the unitive way, through the dark night of the soul, as a time of massive spiritual transformation. We'll talk a little bit more about this next time, so I'm running out of time. The key, of course, here, just like with Jesus in the agony of the garden, is faith, surrendering everything to God. What does He say? Not my will, but yours be done. Offering His very self, so that then the person can enter into the unitive way, this way of the perfected, where a person is in a constant union, a loving union with God. There's heroic charity. They are not sinning. They are not distracted in prayer. I mean, distractions are gone. Like this sounds pretty amazing. They are living a heroic charity. Any suffering is done with a loving union with Jesus crucified. And then we talk about the heights. They talk about the heights of the unit of way is the mystical marriage. And then what can happen in these, this concomitant mystical phenomenon, these mystical touches of the Lord, just touches the soul at a deeper level than anyone else can. These flights of spirit, they're just caught up into the heavens, these fiery darts of love. So you see like the angel piercing St. Teresa of Avila's heart, where it's like this delightful wound where this their heart's on fire. Like when St. Gemma she experienced this, she's like, I'm gonna be a pilot. I mean, she said it in her own St. Gemma way, but my translation is like, Lord, if you don't calm down, I'm gonna like a pile of ashes on the ground, like here, and then go like Jesus just consumed. Gemma just died of love. That's what happened. She's just a pile of ashes. Because it's so intense. It's not painful in the sense of like, ow, ow, ow. But it's so overwhelming. It's like a flames of love, these wounds and flames of love, where just the thirst and longing to go to heaven and be with God is just overwhelmingly strong. Because the Lord is just so captivating the person. And in the prayer of conforming union, so that's the prayer of union, and conforming union, a person's going to experience mystical ecstasy. In mystical ecstasy, the soul is so absorbed. We talked about God captivating the intellect, captivating the will, and then in the deeper prayer, stages of prayer, it captivates the imagination and memory. In mystical ecstasy, it captivates all of the person, body and soul. Every part is in the presence of God. And so like, when this is a photo of St. Gemma in ecstasy. She didn't know they were taking her photo. She did not pose for this. She's in ecstasy, and they would walk up to her, light a match under her hands, and leave it there. And she would not move, and her hands would not burn. That's one of the ways they knew it wasn't some type of trance, some type of faking. Like, they're just, okay, let's test this ecstasy. Doesn't look like it's burning. Right? God would just miraculously protect. She's with Jesus. This is a normal phenomenon in the prayer of conforming union. Sometimes the Lord just lift them off the ground in levitation, like St. Teresa of Avila or St. Philip Neri. They can experience, of course, visions of Jesus. Now, a vision of Jesus is not a proof that someone's in the conforming union. People that are barely beginning in the spiritual life can experience visions, if that's what God chooses to do to try to help them grow in holiness. Visions are not a sign of holiness. But in the Heights, this is a mystical marriage. It's like St. Catherine of Siena, when she was in the prayer of transforming union, Jesus actually appeared to her, and Mary as well, and put a wedding ring on her finger as a sign of this espousal. Because heaven is a marriage, right? We call it the wedding feast of the Lamb. Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Right? We are called the bride of Christ for a reason. That the level of union that the Lord wants, obviously not a physical or sexual type of thing. That's earthly marriage stuff. But a level of union where we are abiding in Him and sharing in His inner life, and He is living in us. He is sharing in our inner life, we're sharing in His. He is living in the depths of our soul. He has wedded Himself to our soul. And that's what heaven is. Okay, so, I'm a little over time here. Okay, so essentials for deeper prayer. Okay, how do we grow? What's the next step? Sanctifying grace, gotta be in a state of grace. Can't grow in your prayer life if you're spiritually dead. So get to confession. Perseverance, probably all know this. Because you start cutting prayer short, I don't feel God close, therefore I'm only gonna spend 20 minutes instead of an hour. No, choose Him. You know, don't base your prayer time based on feelings. Base it on what He deserves and what He's worth. So when there's dryness, persevere. I choose You, Lord. What a great way to make God feel loved. Okay, Lord, I'm not feeling anything, but I ain't about the feeling. I'm about You. And You're still here, and You love me, and that's amazing. I choose You. Recollection, turning away from the noise, as I mentioned. Of course, they talk about the three greatest virtues for growing in the spiritual life are humility, humility, humility. I don't, because the Lord is the one that receives the glory, where we're focusing much more on Him than on us. Not focusing on our feelings, we're getting captivated more and more. You are holy God, You are worthy, You are amazing. And then charity, we pray as we live. So as the love of God grows, love of neighbor will grow. As love of neighbor will grow, love of God will go. Very practically, important to choose time and place. This is probably obvious to everybody here. We gotta actually put it on the calendar. We gotta make a place to pray. You know, we can pray anywhere. Obviously, but if we can make something set of some place apart, that can often help us, right? It's hard to pray at the Grand Central Station, right? Like, you know, if we have a sacred place to pray, and to choose the best time rather than the leftovers. Well, I pray at 10:15 at night when I'm laying in bed with my eyes closed. That's called sleeping. I try to fall asleep praying. That's okay. But if that's your only prayer, then I would say if your only conversation is with your spouse, with your eyes closed, laying in bed as you're trying to fall asleep, you're not having a good relationship, right? So choose the best time. How long should I pray? Depends on how much you are praying. At least start out with something and stay faithful to that something. You know, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, and then grow. You know, some people do a weekly holy hour, and they say, I can't do a holy hour every day, but I can do one once a week. Okay, start with something and work your way up. Okay, if you try to do too much, I'm going to start with 3 hours a day. Like, yeah, see you in a week when you haven't done any of it. So, okay, make real time. Share your heart with the Lord. Pour out your love on Jesus. Make him feel loved. He can feel loved by you. A beautiful thing. We can make God feel loved by us. Frequently turn to him, dwelling in your soul. If we're in a state of grace, God is dwelling in our soul. And as you know, Eucharistic adoration, daily mass, these are the supercharges. Okay, so St. Teresa gives us this encouragement. It says, I think if I understood then, as I do now, how this great king really dwells within this little palace of my soul, I should not have left him alone so often, but should have stayed with him and never allowed his dwelling place to get so dirty, right? So it's like, if I knew now what I knew, if I knew then what I knew now, oh man. Okay, so let's start. Don't get discouraged and be like, oh, I'm X years old and I should have known this when I was 5. Yeah, great. So I could have said the same thing. But you know it now. So now take the next step. Okay, so what we're going to focus in on is just vocal prayer a little bit of just zoning in with this devotion to the Lord. You know, and sometimes you maybe have heard this this acronym, ACTS, Adoration, Contrition, Thanksgiving, Supplication. And we're just going to spend some time in some prayer. I'm supposed to take questions first. And then we're supposed to pray. That's what the slide said, Father. You got to follow the slides there. Okay, so if we're starting off in a prayer life, you know, we say, okay, these are the prayers out of the prayer book that I say. Great, awesome, nothing wrong with that. But it's important to try to start to make it personal, to try to start to move towards a conversation with God. So that it's not just, these are the prayers out of this prayer book. I've been saying them for 70 years. Well, did you tell God about the loss of your spouse? These are the prayers I say out of my prayer book. No, the Lord wants to make sure we're sharing our heart with him. And so formal prayers, great, awesome, as a good way of expressing the heart, but want to make sure that we actually start sharing our hearts directly, and there's not going to be a prayer out of somebody's prayer book that's going to cover every single emotion that we think of. I mean, the Psalms will cover a lot, but the Lord wants us to talk to him as well. And so some of the kind of the four categories that we could structure a conversation, maybe you spend 5 minutes on each one of these or 3 minutes on each one of them, is worshiping God. You are holy, Lord. And the Psalms are filled with great opportunities of praise you. Praise be Jesus Christ. You know, you are worthy. That's what he says. Oh God, you are my God. For you I long. For you my soul is thirsting. Contrition, asking the Lord for forgiveness. I'm sorry that I neglected that person. I'm sorry I didn't do that. I'm sorry that I didn't make more time for prayer. Thanksgiving, thanking God for his goodness, for who he is, all that he's done for us, all the daily graces, and then, of course, the great graces through Jesus Christ. And then supplication, asking. The Lord wants us to bring our hearts. He wants us to bring our needs. He says, ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door will be opened. Well, Father among you, if his had a son asked for a loaf of bread, would give him a serpent, or a scorpion, or I can't remember the fish, or ask for a fish and would give him a scorpion, or, it's all in there. Whichever ones that were, whatever ones that were, Jesus said something like that. So, he wants us to bring our needs to him. And he says, if you who are wicked know how to give good things, how much more will the Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask of him? Okay, so now, again, this is the water hose. This is the overview of the spiritual life. We're going to dive into some vocal prayer of praying, or vocal and mental prayer of praying through emotions, Ignatian meditation and Ignatian contemplation. We're going to talk about prayer of inner healing, how to allow the Lord to heal some of the wounds that we've experienced throughout life, from others or from ourselves, and then dive into the mystical prayer at some of these deeper stages and kind of go through some quotes of the saints and really try to put some gas on the fire of like, wow, I want that. Like when I read, I don't remember which came first, The Life of St. Gemma Galgani, this book I read by her spiritual director, Father Germanus, or spiritual theology class. I don't remember which came first, but when I read the 3 chapters of her on prayer, what her prayer life was, and all the mystical phenomenon, and all the way she talked about this fire of love, I was like, one, you are amazing, St. Gemma, please be my friend. And then two, I want that. I want that. And to be able to hear the Lord then say, like, yeah, I actually want that too. Let's do this. This isn't for just a few monks in the monastery that pray 7 hours a day. You seek me. He says, seek me with all your heart, I will be found by you. That's what he promises in Jeremiah. Okay, so, any questions? Yes, Will.
So, Father Hartley, when it comes to Saint Ignatius of Loyola,
yes.
So he's the founder of the Jesuits?
He's the founder of the Jesuits, yes. The Society of Jesus. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so he writes, he has the spiritual exercises that he came up with after his conversion as a way of growing in the spiritual life, which are mostly focused around the life of Christ. And then he kind of spells out what Ignatian meditation is and Ignatian contemplation is. And we're going to see that. Now, there's other spiritual authors that talk, that kind of structure how to do meditation. You've got Lectio Divina, which is a more Benedictine method from Guido the Carthusian, actually. That's his name. There may have been others, but he wrote about it. You've got the Carmelite method, you'll see the similarities, but I like St. Ignatius' stuff. So I like the Carmelite stuff too, but I like St. Ignatius' stuff a little bit better. So.
And follow-ups.
Yes. Oh, so no, yeah, conversion of heart. So he grew up Catholic, but wasn't really practicing, became a soldier and was trying to win earthly fame and honor, and then in a battle got his leg shattered by a cannonball, and the enemy that captured him actually let him go, actually carried him to his brother's house. They were so impressed by his valor. I mean, that's amazing. And then while he was recouping, he realized, like, his brother didn't have any, like, all the kind of like war novels and war comic book type of things that he used to read. He just had the life of Christ and the lives of the saints. And so he started to have this conversion of like, what if I lived like that? What if I lived for Jesus? And then eventually he had this conversion and went to Our Lady of Montserrat in Manresa, Our Lady of Montserrat, and surrendered his sword and everything, and then went to Manresa, lived in a cave, cared for the poor in a hospital, and was praying like 6-7 hours a day, I think. And that's where he developed the spiritual exercises and has made a profound impact on the world because of it. Other questions? Yes, please.
How do people pray for 6 hours a day?
Usually monks and nuns, so I've spent time in monasteries, I know. Usually you're not praying 6 hours straight. You're usually going to break up your day. And so, like in a monastery, you might start your day with a holy hour in the morning, and then some of that's going to, or a couple hours, maybe like, let's see. So when I was with a religious order and we were praying 5.5 hours a day, you know, you would start with adoration, you'd have a holy hour in silence where you're maybe doing some meditation and adoration of Jesus, and then you'd have morning prayer, and we'd pray the office or readings at midnight, and then morning prayer, and then you'd have mass, and then we'd go to breakfast, and then you'd come back and do another 30 minutes of adoration, and then you'd go off and do your work, and then you'd come back and do another hour of adoration, and then come back. So you'd usually split up the day. Now, if someone is in deeper stages of prayer, like contemplation, 6 hours can go by like that. If they're in a mystical ecstasy, if they're in mystical contemplation, they're not paying attention to the time. God's got them. But I would just say, like, yeah, God is not asking they say St. Thomas More started his day with 4 hours of prayer. I don't really know the source on that, but that's what I've heard. But typically, a married person with kids isn't going to be able to do as much as a monk or a nun, obviously. So God is not asking them to do that. And God is not making their sanctification based on being able to pray as much as a monk or nun does. He's making their sanctification based on how much can they pray as a wife or a mother, a husband and a father with their lives, which is not 5 minutes a day. Anybody who can only say, I can only pray 5 minutes a day, it's like, dude, you need to make some changes to your life because you're missing out. It's like saying, I can only talk to your wife 5 minutes a day. Change your life. You change your life, dude. Like, unless it's like wartime and you're starving to death and like whatever, you know. Okay, yes, all the way in the back.
I have to pray like 12 every waking hour of the day, just by talking.
Sure. So, yeah, but the scriptures talk about praying without ceasing, and that can mean multiple things. There's multiple ways to kind of live that out. One is we try to just talk to God throughout the day. And so we might call those spontaneous prayers. That's a very, very good thing. We should talk to God throughout the day. While we're doing the laundry, we can talk to God. While we're driving in the car, we can talk to God. We can be talking to Him as we're walking down the street. So that's a way to kind of bring prayer throughout the day. But it's also important, and I mentioned this in one of the slides here, maybe, no, I don't know, is to not multitask prayer as well. I mean, we can pray while we're doing other things, but if our only prayer is multitasked prayer, I only pray while I'm doing other things, then we're going to miss out. God does want some quality time, right? I only talk to my spouse while I'm doing the laundry. You should have a date night. Just them, just you and them, right? Yeah, it's good to talk to your spouse while you're doing other things, but it's also good to just have some one-on-one FaceTime, right? So sometimes prayer without ceasing can mean praying throughout the day, but the height of prayer without ceasing is the transforming union, where you are constantly in a mystical union with God all the time. You are literally mystically praying without ceasing. So, any other questions? How are we doing on time? Okay, it is time to pray, people. Time to pray. Okay, so what I want to do is just take. Let's say start here. I want you just to kind of read the scriptures. Allow the Lord to speak to you. These scriptures on the Lord's desire for union with you. All these things that we've talked about, the Lord wants for you. He wants to fill you with His life. He wants to live in you. He wants to fill your soul with His infinite love and presence and make you radiant with joy. He wants that. He died on a cross to make it happen. He conquered sin and death to make it happen. He has literally gone to hell and back to make it happen. He's not the stingy one here. He is passionate about you. He is passionate about you sharing in His life and being filled with His love. And so we can... So I just want to spend some time just kind of receiving the word of the Lord on that, and then just encourage you to talk to the Lord for a bit. If there's any areas of discouragement, like to surrender all of that. I surrender that, Lord. You are all powerful. You know? And to ask for the grace to take the next step. And so we have our response. So we have some vocal prayers. So we're just going to take some time, let the Lord speak to you, and then spend some time responding, and then we'll have a little small group discussion on that, okay? And let's just start formally with a prayer. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Father, please help us to pray. As we read your word to us, your love letter to us, please let us receive that word and respond to you with love and devotion, for you are good. I ask that in Jesus' name. All right, guys. Hope that led to some good conversation and maybe a little fellowship with some parishioners you may or may not have known before today. Each night when we talk about these things, we'll have a time for prayer and a time to have some small group, just because it can be a source of encouragement and insight and hopefully realize, I'm not this weird alien I'm not the only one who experiences dryness in prayer. I'm not the only one who was trying to pray as Father asked us to do and was experiencing distractions about, did I leave the stove on? You know, we all experience all these things. So I just want to close with this, a beautiful quote from St. John of the Cross, which I just find so inspiring, and then just leave you with a couple resources and then give you a blessing if you'll allow me to. He says in the living flame of love, he says, God communicates himself to the soul in the measure of its purity. That's why the Lord wants us to turn away from sin. God communicates himself to the soul in the measure of its purity. And we see here Jesus' words, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. He says, and the soul in turn communicates itself to God in the measure of its transformation by grace. What do we want? Everybody here wants to love God, right? Everybody here wants to offer their lives to God. That we can offer our lives in a much more supernatural level, offer our entire selves when the Lord is transforming us by His grace, where we're allowing Him to purify us, and then we're allowing Him to make of us an eternal offering to Him. I love that line.
In turn, the soul in turn communicates itself to God in the measure of its transformation by grace, because this is a grace. Okay, so some resources that you might consider, just kind of at the various levels. Prayer for Beginners by Dr. Peter Creech is just a great kind of intro prayer on vocal prayer and meditation. If you want to kind of dive more into the deep end, Fulfillment of All Desire by Dr. Ralph Martin. Fire Within by Father Thomas DeBay. Now, Fire Within is pretty thick, so be forewarned. I've tried to read that, and I'm like, this is really thick. So Fulfillment of All Desire might be a bigger intro. Spiritual Canticle by St. John of the Cross and Interior Castle by St. Teresa of Avila are two of the great masterpieces of spiritual theology. One of my favorite books is actually our textbook from spiritual theology. Now, this is a textbook, be forewarned. I'm like, oh, Father, this was so, like, this is a textbook, and it's very precise. That's why I like it. It's precise. It's Thomistic. It's good. So it's Spiritual Theology by Father Jordan Ammon, which it's great. His section on his chapter on the nine grades of prayer is just very inspiring. And then there's even apps to help us pray, like the Hallow app that we were kind of showcasing during Lent and Easter, the Amen app by Augustine Institute, which is free. The Liturgy of the Hours, you know, the prayer of the church, the official prayer of the church, is a free app created by a priest, actually. So the iBreviary. And there's a great website called spiritualdirection.com. I think they have an app as well, but spiritualdirection.com, where they have all these conversations about the spiritual life. So I thank you all for being here. I want to close with a prayer and a blessing. And hope to see you in the next few weeks if you're able to make it. So let's start with a prayer of trust, right? Because we look at all these spiritual life, if we experience this desire, I want this, Lord. And don't get discouraged. Don't let the evil one sow discouragement. You'll never have that. No, my trust is in Jesus Christ. My trust is not in my own ability to walk on water. My trust is in the Lord Jesus to pick me up. My trust is in my Father in heaven and the Lord Jesus. He loves me. He wants to get me there. If I cling to him, if I seek him, he will not let me down. Okay, so let's close with this prayer of trust. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, in all my temptations, I place my trust in you, O Sacred Heart of Jesus. In all my weaknesses, I place my trust in you, O Sacred Heart of Jesus. In all my difficulties, I place my trust in you, O Sacred Heart of Jesus. In all my trials, I place my trust in you, O Sacred Heart of Jesus. In all my sorrows, I place my trust in you, O Sacred Heart of Jesus. In all my works, I place my trust in you, O Sacred Heart of Jesus. In every failure, I place my trust in you, O Sacred Heart of Jesus. In every discouragement, I place my trust in you, O Sacred Heart of Jesus. In life and in death, I place my trust in you, O Sacred Heart of Jesus. In time and in eternity, I place my trust in you, Sacred Heart of Jesus. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord turn his face to you and be gracious to you. May the Lord shine his countenance upon you and fill you with peace. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace. Amen. All right. Have a good night, guys.